All right, guys, starting out the stream. Here we go. Things are still getting set up, though, so we'll see how this is going to go.
Cool. All right. How do you share this? Twitter? That's not it.
How does that new age technology work again?
I know, right? No. Share via Twitter. Kernel's getting jiggy with it. There we go. All right. I'm not going to be in the chat because I got too much going on. All right. So anybody that's in the game, please do not join the stream.
Boo.
Yep. Bah humbug. All right. All right, everybody ready? Just unmute if you are, just so I can see everybody.
Hola.
Sweet. All right, I apologize ahead of time. I've been sick all week, so may not be as jovial as I have been in the past. But we'll tough through it. All right. So in the previous session, everybody had was going to do a long rest. So everybody should count themselves as having done a long rest. And yes, I said jovial. You've all got a long rest, so replenish your stats as you need to. And the last thing that we had done before the session ended was that Duran, I believe, was the lookout. He was on watch, and he had fallen asleep. So, with that, we will begin today's session.
Way to go, Durden. You've doomed us all.
Sleep on the job.
This better be some magical sleep. Otherwise, I'm getting a new dwarf. This one seems defective.
Colonel mean to mute himself.
I did because I had to clear my throat. Thank you. All right, so you all begin dreaming, and you are visited in your dream by a man that calls himself Emissary Kluger. And I'm going to share a handout with you.
Whoa, now, we don't know each other like that.
So Emissary Kluger appears, and he is a modest but respectfully dressed human male with a tinge of orange in his close-cropped hair. His outfit is a tailored brown tweed with a red velvet vest and a blue-collared linen shirt. He wears a green cap on his head with a black brim. And on the front of the cap is a symbol of three stars, orange, yellow, and red, arranged in a triangle. He tells you that he introduces himself as SD Kluger, and he says that the SD stands for Special Delivery, his forte in delivering on Lyra's requests. And he identifies himself as an emissary of the goddess Lyra. And let me share this with you. All right. Everybody should see that in your in your handouts.
Are you serious?
I'm serious. So he is a messenger from the goddess Lyra, and she is searching for true heroes to help her in her time of need. Are you willing to help?
Well, I am a true hero, so I am willing to help.
Jordan is pretty sure he's extremely drunk right now and will agree to anything.
So he appears before you. You're kind of you're asleep, but you seem to be aware. You're kind of disembodied, and you can see him kind of at the center of the camp. And he's looking at each of you, trying to determine if all of you are in or if any of you are not.
Does he look like a puppet?
He does not look like a puppet. He does kind of look like a, believe that is Fred Astaire.
Okay. Who will join me in aiding this handsome fellow?
Sure. Yeah, why not?
All right.
I'm sensing a lack of enthusiasm here, guys. Come on.
It's Christmas Eve. Get into the spirit. All right. So I'm assuming everybody's in. If not, please say so. So the scene in your dream switches to... Oh my god, are you kidding me? It's not letting me switch. It's not letting me switch. Why is it not letting me switch? Oh, good lord.
Improvise.
Okay, we're gonna improvise here. Suspend your belief. There we go. Okay. So the scene in your in the dreamscape switches to an image of a town called Helmfirth, and you find that you have no form, and your perspective is just behind Kluger as he turns to look out into the town. And he says that the festival of Yuletide is in peril, and will deprive people of one of the few times of the year where they can experience joy and happiness. Gods don't intervene in the workings of mortals, or they try not to, but instead they use pawns to enact their will. The Yuletide Festival in the town of Helmfirth is an annual celebration during the winter solstice that brings the joy not only to the town of Helmfirth, but even to parts of the Feywild. The positivity and compassion during this time is effusive and provides great resilience. But most importantly, Helmfirth needs this festival. It is a bleak town in the southern foothills of the Helmcrest Mountains and is isolated. This is one of their few opportunities for celebration. The scene switches to images of people appearing to attend a festival in the town square around a large decorated tree. They don't seem especially happy, almost as if they're going through the motions, talking and gathering around the tree, just having conversation. Not a lot of smiles on their faces. Kluger says, "Years ago, this festival was a much-to-do affair. People of all ages perform music, danced, feasted, and had a jolly time. But as the town fell on difficult times, their spirit waned, and the festival lost much of its shine. Sadly, Lyra, the Lady of Joy, can't force people to have fun, only provide the means. It wasn't until a young cleric emerged in Helmfirth that things started to change. The dreamscape changes to scenes of people, mostly the poor, but even the fortunate, with smiles on their faces, most especially the children, and a young man gives out handmade toys to them. Kluger says, his name is Kringle, Nicholas Kringle. And Nicholas is a human cleric of Ilmater, who has a talent for crafting things. In his teens, he grew up as the only child of a family of some wealth, persevering through the suffering of the death of his parents and learning in the Church of Ilmater. He trained as a healing cleric and put his gift of craft to use by setting up a workshop with his inheritance to make toys to give to poor children so they might have joy in their lives. Wealthy parents saw the joy that they brought the children and the quality of craftsmanship and were willing to pay top dollar. Nicholas used the proceeds of the sale of the toys to make more toys and expand his workshop. A few years back, he started a tradition during the Yuletide Festival where he gives away toys to poor children so they can have joy and hope through this festive time of the year. During his travels to Nor Pool, a gnome town on the north side of Helmcrest Mountains, he often recruits the best and brightest gnomes of the church and hires them to help him in the workshop. Any leftover money he has is donated to the church. And I will share that with you. The dreamscape again changes to a large, happy festival. Seemingly with the whole town attending, games, food, exchanges of gifts, and Nicholas giving toys and hope to the poor. Kluger says, Lyra sees amazing joy and great things for the people of Helmfirth, all because of this one man and his great deeds. We would be lucky to have him as a fellow disciple of Lyra. But alas, he's chosen his path with Ilmater and is a perfect fit. And however, Kluger says, Lyra sees amazing joy and great things. I already said that one. The minions of Loviator are at work today. And Lyra needs your help. Loviator is the evil goddess of pain and agony. She's a cold-hearted bully, calculating and despotic, and the master of inflicting physical and psychological suffering. And I will share that with you. Without the Yuletide Festival, the goddess sees despair and pain overrunning the town, sapping the poor people of their will and happiness, surely leading to the town's demise. Kluger turns to address the group, the bleak landscape remaining in view behind him. Lyra needs your help. Helmfirth needs your help. But most importantly, the poor and unfortunate need your help to preserve the joy and happiness in their future. Are you ready to go?
Yeah, let's knock it out then. Do they usually have booze at these festivals?
He kind of glances at you, kind of at the side of his eye. He's not quite sure what to make of it. And he says, I'm sure there will be. But we have to save the festival first.
I don't know, there's nothing like get you in the saving mood like a drink, eh?
So if I understand correctly, we have to fight for our right to party?
I'll see what you did that.
Let's do it.
Cougar just turns away. All right.
Let's hope Erod's Abwax doesn't freeze in the cold.
All right.
Don't worry, I got the all-weather stuff.
So Emissary Kluger stands in front of you in the snow-covered town square of Helmfirth, but doesn't appear to leave any footprints. You, however, do. Behind him is the large decorated tree from your dream, and off to the left is a large, sloppily put-together snowman with a corncob pipe, two lumps of coal for eyes, a carrot for nose, and branches sticking out of his torso as arms, with a broom leaning against one of them. It is passed on, but it is still relatively dark due to the mountains. The sky glows of morning through gray snow clouds, the ambient sound dampened as if from a recent snowfall. The air is crisp, but not bone-chilling, and you feel that you don't need any extra layers to keep warm. There is very little activity in the town. Kruger looks at the group, and actually, let me put you all on the map, which I didn't do.
Do we still have our weapons on us?
You do have everything that you had when you fell asleep.
Makashi stabs them.
I was trying not to. I'm so holding back. This whole time, I'm just like, just don't take out the sword, please. Just don't take it out. My hand is shaking.
Just resist.
So we have established that all of these people are puppets. Look like that. Canonically.
No, I'm very freaked out.
They don't look like that. It's meant to be fun.
Okay. Okay. And then Mikasa becomes big and attacks everything.
I have an extreme fear of puppet-looking people.
Yeah, they're not puppet-looking people. All right, so you guys are kind of all arranged, however you are, kind of at the front here. So Kluger turns to you, and he says, he implores you, time is of the essence. Loviator's minions are in the area, but we don't know where. Keep your eye out for anything out of the ordinary. Out of the ordinary, for a sleeping mountain town, that is. Maybe the locals have heard something, I'm not sure. He identifies that the building to the north, this one here, everybody see that?
I see it.
Might need to zoom out.
The big cross-shaped one.
Yep.
The domes.
So he identifies that building is the Church of His Sacrifice, and it is Ilmater's church. He also identifies...
There's an attack helicopter.
He also identifies this building here to the west as Nicholas's workshop complex. And he also identifies this building here as the stables. The building to the left of the Church of Ilmater is the Church of Lyra. And on the south side of the square, the blue building is the tavern. The building to the left of it is the inn. And these three buildings here are town offices. What would the party like to do?
Tavern first.
Yeah.
Okay. All right. So you all hop into the tavern. And you see It's a very large tavern. You said the tavern or the inn?
The tavern.
Tavern. I'm sorry. Tavern. All right. So you're in the tavern.
I just assumed Durden would have ran in that direction first.
Absolutely.
So the it's not very busy. It seems to be kind of mid-morning, early morning. The bartender's there. There's a couple of wait staff just kind of chatting in the corner. And there's maybe one or two patrons at the bar. What would you guys like to do?
Talk to the person at the bar. See what they have on tap.
Ask them if they realize there's a man made out of snow just outside.
So he lists off a few different kind of ales. They do serve a warm drink for the children. They call it cocoa. And he kind of looks at Rorali when she was it who asked about the snowman? Was it Rorali or
Alan?
Alan.
We sound the same, so
yeah.
I apologize. I'm hopped up on NyQuil. So he kind of looks strangely at you, and he says, it's a snowman.
Well, that's what I said. A man of snow. Is that, what race is that? Do they come from the north?
He just looks very confused.
I was too embarrassed to ask him directly.
It's obviously a snow elemental.
Obviously. Come on, Alan, get with the time.
You guys are strange. What'll it be?
Have none of you idiots seen a snowman before?
Probably.
I assume they aren't hostile beings.
Nah, they're not hostile.
Bartender's looking impatient. He's wanting to know what you want to do. And,
I ask if he has any pumpkin flavored ale, because I'm really sad that I missed the pumpkin festival in Phandelver.
Aye, we do. He pours a pint and gives it to you. That'll be one silver.
In a dream world? God, you guys are... And I give it to him. Fucking one silver. I get to stay in
Did
the fucking...
Did you say that out loud, or are you just commenting to the DM?
Yeah, I say it aloud. No filter on Rorali.
He just kind of chuckles and says, if this is a dream world, it's getting close to being a nightmare.
Oh, you should see where we come from.
He turns to everybody else and asks if there's anything you want to drink. And you can hear one of the patrons kind of chuckle to himself and mutter something under his breath.
Fucking Taurus, probably.
I need a drink that matches my taste in women. Stout and bitter.
he nods appreciatively in your direction and pours you one and hands it to you.
Do you have eggnog here?
He kind of he pauses to consider and says, "You know what? I think I might. Give me one second." And he turns and goes into the back room. And as he does that, you can hear screams and crashing noises coming from the direction of the town square, from where you just entered the door. A small gnome dressed in a red pointy cap, green and red striped robes, and a red leather boots runs into the tavern. It's alive! Rusty Wingets and Flipsy Doodads! That was close! I think it's coming! It's heading for the church! We're doomed! It's destroying everything!
You made fun of us.
What?
I look at Durden and I say, I thought you said the thing was harmless.
What thing?
Gosh, he says, I fucking know it. He draws his sword and runs outside.
I follow him.
Durden's gonna down his beer before he runs out with the others.
Alright.
I run out with it. For fucking one silver, I'm taking the goddamn goblet. Yeah, special edition. Writing that down in my inventory.
Did you say you were taking the goblet?
The thing that the beer came in.
Oh, okay. Okay. I thought you said goblin. I thought you were okay. My bad. All right. So the
that's not terrifying.
So everybody heads out to the heads out to the square. Oh, actually, who's headed out the square? Just put yourselves on the cobblestone path there.
I was right behind Makashi.
All right. There you go. So this guy's kind of over here by now. And he's just kind of making a mess of things. And you roll a... Actually... So Durden and Makashi probably. Durden and Makashi, you kind of sense that the gnome that kind of came running in terrified is kind of standing behind the party, but he's kind of watching what's going on. He's very very excited. He's like, oh, this is great. It's a battle. Oh, this is so exciting. There's not been this much excitement in this town. And he's just kind of following where you guys are going. All right. So, what are you guys doing?
How big is the terrifying snowman?
Oops. So the snowman is he's large. He's pretty much about the same size as he was before. He's a large snowman, so he takes up a lot of space. He's probably about 8 feet tall. It's kind of got a base of around 4 to 5 feet. It's a large snowman.
I run towards it.
I guess my first action is going to be hit Rurali with a shield of faith.
All right. Everybody roll initiative.
Yeah.
Like literally just punches her with the power of gods.
I'm like, ah, God, damn it. I thought we were friends. You're spilling my drink. Yeah.
Durden's lagging behind because he stayed to get a drink to finish it.
What does Shield of Faith give me? Plus 2 to AC?
Plus 2 to AC, right?
Yep.
All right. So might help if I bring up the initiative list. There we go.
Wow, that snowman is quick.
All right, so everybody's in. Okay, Rurali, you were running after it. Where are you getting to? I'll give you the first move.
Let's see. 15, 20, 25, 30. I get to there.
All right, are you doing anything?
As my action, I finish my drink and I stash it away and I take out my and I carefully place the cup in my backpack and I take out my fancy sword and I stand there and I wipe my mouth at it and I'm like, ah, I've never fought one of you before.
Okay. All right, so Frosty is up and he is going to move up here. All right. Makashi.
Dashing around the opposite side of the building.
So for that's now.
20, 25, 30, 35, 40, 45, 50, 55, 60, and that's it.
Okay. Alan. Alan's going to move up 10, 20, I guess to about here. Cast mage armor on himself, I guess, and call out to this man of snow. Hark, you jolly happy soul with a corncob pipe and a button nose and two eyes made out of coal. How are you? That's the end of my turn. I don't know. Does he seem mean and angry? I mean, what's he doing? Is he paying attention to us? Or?
He doesn't. He looks not good. He's a.
Is he wearing pants?
He looks like a possessed evil snowman.
You said he was like destroying stuff, right?
Yeah, he's just kind of destroying things in his path that's preventing him from getting to what appears to be the church.
I thought you guys said snowmen were harmless. All right, that's my turn.
Jordan.
All
right. Okay, this is the first snowman I've ever seen come alive and try to do whatever it's doing. Durden is going to all out up to here. That's double movement speed for dash, right?
Yep.
Yeah.
Yep, that's where it gets me. And that's I'm going to hold off on doing anything. Yeah, I'll just hold for now.
Okay. Barali.
I rolled a 7. Not an 8. I should be last in initiative.
You know what? I didn't sort it. It just worked out that way.
There you go.
Irod. Thank you.
All right, so I'm going to dash to there.
Okay. Do anything else?
Just flexing my abs. That's all.
Okay.
Getting that cold workout out.
Standing there flexing the abs.
Just try not to poke any eyes out.
It is a little nipply. All right, Archon.
You said there's snow on the ground?
Yeah, it's snow covered.
I begin creating another snowman.
Okay.
Amazing. Is your name Elsa?
Like,
do you want to build a snowman?
You're just making a snowman?
Yeah, I mean, how else do you fight a snowman but with another snowman?
Okay. Do you have the ability to animate it?
Oh, we'll see.
Okay. All right, so Archon is building a snowman.
He's going to Bugs Bunny it, dress it up in a sexy dress, and
it will be a female snow woman. Really?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. All right.
Sexual orientation.
Are you doing movement or? Oh, actually, yeah. Well, it's going to take you a full turn to do that. So, yeah, you're not going to be able to move.
Be snow person.
A snow person. All right, Rurali.
I move here, and I'm like, "Don't run from me! I'm trying to fight you." And that's all I can do. That's my sexy movement.
Okay.
Fucking rude, man.
Makashi.
I will 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 move up to here, taking out two kunai and throwing both of them at the back of its, what I assume to be its head.
Okay.
And since Virali's next to him, I can get sneak attack on that.
Okay.
Or on one of them. So that's...
Ooh.
Fail.
It's the first one, right? It's the first one, right? Not the second one.
For what?
Well, you're only throwing one kunai, right?
I was throwing two.
Oh, okay. You can throw two? All right. So you get sneak attack on both?
Just the one.
Just the one. The first one.
Well, it's on one that hits. Well, I don't know. It doesn't specify like that the sneak attack doesn't go through if you're doing two attacks and one doesn't hit. So I assume it's on the one that you want to have sneak attack on, because you only get sneak attack once per turn.
Right, so you need to tell me which attack was the sneak attack.
The second one.
Okay, so the first one... the first one flies between Frosty and Morali and kind of tings off the building, and the second one does hit. And that is for... 7 damage. And so it hits Frosty in the back of the head. It doesn't seem to do as much damage as you think it normally would do.
I have no idea what kind of damage it would do. This thing's weird. I'm just trying to get its attention.
You got its attention. It kind of swats at the back of its head and just kind of roars in as it. Are you doing any other thing on your turn?
No, that's it for me.
Okay. So he, Frosty, he just swats at the back of his head and just roars, and he. He kind of turns as he's kind of turning around to look at who threw that at him. Raleigh kind of steps in front of him, and he just roars in frustration, "Get out of my way!" And he is going to attack Raleigh since she's right in front of him.
I laugh in the face of danger. Ha, ha, ha.
And both miss?
Ho, ho, ho.
All right.
Ho, ho, ho.
So he kind of swings his arms at you and just can't grab hold or do anything. Misses and just is really getting pissed off. And he is going to...
Clark revenge.
Move closer to the door. Alan.
Okay, I'm going to move to here. Is that line of sight or no?
Yeah, should be. Yep. Yeah, okay. I'll give you line of sight.
All right.
I think that's going to be like, I'll give that 1/4 cover.
Okay, well, I will attempt to force bolt him through his 1/4 cover.
Okay.
Yay. Is that good?
I hope so.
Let me make sure of
25.
Cover. Oh, there's 3 degrees of cover. There is no 1/4 cover. yeah, it's you got line of sight. You rolled a 25. That hits.
Take that, Boston. Is everybody laughing at me right now? Is that what's actually happening?
He kind of reaches back reflexively and just scratches his butt where you hit him.
And he has no pants, right?
He's just a snowman.
Why would a snowman have pants?
Well, men wear pants. Why wouldn't a snowman wear pants?
They don't usually make snowmen with legs.
Does he have legs?
He's got... Yeah, no, he doesn't have legs.
So he's just kind of like scooting along like a slug or something?
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. All right. That's my turn.
Does the force bolt force anything? Did they get pushed back with that?
No.
No.
Durden's going to hold up his holy symbol and chant a prayer to cling it in and send a bolt of holy fire at this fucking snowman.
All right.
He's make a dex save.
Okay. He's a 14.
Correct.
Does that save or does that hit? I think that's a save, right?
If he got 14 or better, he saves.
Yep, he saves. Anything else?
Nope, that's it. That's all I can move.
All right, Erod.
All right, gonna channel his inner Tom Cruise and run really fast up to there.
Okay.
And then flex his abs.
All right. Flex and getting prepared for the battle.
Indeed.
Archon.
Have I finished building my snow person?
How big are you making it?
6 seconds?
At least the same size as the other snow, the frosty.
No, you're not.
Then I continue to build my snow person.
Okay.
The best snow person ever.
Rurali.
Oh, shit. Hold on. Okay, I just minimize it. I'm like, come on, dude! And I stand there and I hit him.
Okay.
I don't want to be friends, but I want to fight you. Stop running.
Right. That hits. All right. So as you slash him once, right?
Yeah.
As you slash him, the blade just kind of slices through the snow, and the snow forms back for the most part. It some of it is left behind on the ground, so it has hit him.
And he doesn't split into more, right?
No.
Asking for a friend.
No, he doesn't.
Okay. Frosty's filled with a black pudding inside. Is that what we're...
Yeah.
It's vanilla.
No.
Oh, God.
Gross.
Then that is my move. Do I have any bonus cool things with this character? No, I don't. That's my move.
All right.
Yeah.
Makashi.
Really not cool about getting into melee with this thing. 10, 15, 20. So I'm gonna throw my last kunai at it again.
Okay.
Critical.
All right. And
plus four.
All right. Oh, you did. Oh, that's the crit.
The crit
is 3.
Yeah, the D6 is my sneak attack.
Oh, okay. Okay.
Yeah, I'm not going to get any closer to it.
All right. Okay. Frosty's up. All right. So he realizes that he's got to deal with you people. So he, instead of turning from the door, he turns back toward Rurali, and just wants to take you out, you people.
What do you mean, you people?
I take offense to that, Mr. Snowman. No elemental.
All right, so he's going to hit you with...
Do it.
Doesn't happen to be an atheist snowman.
He's going to use his broom and just kind of get you out of the way. And does the 11 hit?
Not even in his dreams. In their dreams, sorry.
All right.
So wait, no. I have to be hit for the dex save, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, no.
All right. He's getting really, really frustrated. He's not understanding why he can't hit you. Neither is the DM. All right.
I have a big shit-eating grin.
He's just going to hold right there. All right, Alan.
All right. Up here, and another force bolt. Come on, big money.
That hits.
Yay. Ooh.
All right, so the force bolt hits and kind of blows a small chunk of the snow away, doing damage. All right. Anything else?
Nope. That's my turn.
All right. Dryden.
Dryden is going to move up. And swing his hammer for the snowman's head. Okay. Or whatever the highest bed he can reach.
From with your height, probably about upper torso, maybe. And that hits.
And I am going to activate my domain power for a second swing.
Okay. And that hits too.
Then that'll be my turn.
All right. Irad.
Okay, so I am going to go right there along the building.
Okay.
And then strikes my pose, reaches out, and hits him with burning hands.
All right, so where are you aiming that cone?
Because
this is a 15-foot cone.
So...
I can take it. Aim it towards me.
Okay, so you can... Yeah, you'll be able to hit it, but you'd have to kind of aim this way. So you'll get it if you're trying to avoid hitting them.
And the church.
I will allow that. I think it's only a creature, right? Every creature.
Yeah.
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 Fire ignites any flammable objects in the area that aren't being worn or carried.
So, like, center it right here, so the outside gets him.
Yeah.
You could totally aim it towards me. You know from for a fact that I am resistant to fire.
Okay, we'll do a direct on shot. So barely outside of Duradin, but Viraldi will be in it.
All right. So the you managed to hit the corner of the building. but thankfully the corner is made of metal. It just singes some of the wood that's around it. So it hasn't gone up in flames. But it was a close call. You do hit Viraldi. And so roll, how much damage is it? 3d6. Okay, so roll a 3d6.
Do I make it with a 12?
Probably not.
Oops, wrong one. Working on it, sorry.
Yeah, what is your spell casting DC?
Does that work?
Yeah.
So you on your character sheet on the spells thing?
No, not as well.
Okay.
What does it say your DC is? Your spell DC.
It's the big number in the middle. Spell safe
DC. Yeah, and your spell sheet.
Oh, spell save.
Yeah.
13.
Okay, so he rolled a 14, so it doesn't hit him, but it does hit Raleigh.
Dang it.
What's half of 13?
6.
And so the snowman will take half damage.
Yeah.
Sorry, that's right. So the damage was 3d6, and he rolled 3d7. Oh, there you go. 13. All right, I'll take 13. So that's 6. All right.
I imagine a snowman would be vulnerable to fire damage, would he not?
A snowman?
He would.
So you would think. Still 13.
Looks like it melted. It melted more than you would think it would. Let me put it that way.
Is his face melting?
His face is not melting. All right, is that your turn?
And that's my turn, yep.
All right, Archon. I'll give you one more turn and then your snowman's built.
He is still building his snowman. He will be back in 5.
Okay. Raleigh.
I attack this mofo once more. There is my attack. I assume that hits?
That hits.
Whew.
All right. So once again, it slices through the snow, almost like butter. Leaving some on the ground. Any movement?
Nope, I stay there.
All right, Makashi.
Now a little bit more confident with people up in front of him. I'll move up to the side and swipe at him.
Okay.
Wait. Ninja Ken. 19. And I will also one-arm strike him.
Okay, so the first one hits, the second one misses.
All right, and now I sneak attack that. Oh, I should probably get rid of the roll, but yeah, +4.
All right. So what is the sneak attack roll?
I'm trying to make it custom thing on the attacks and spell casting part of this character sheet. Didn't mean to make it a roll. Should come up like that. There you go.
Okay.
So there isn't a roll.
All right. So I'll take the 4. It's 1d6, right?
Yeah.
Right, I'll take the 4. Oh, wait. So the sneak attack was the second one?
The sneak attack is along with the first one. Okay. The ninja can hit.
All right. Let me check something quickly. All right, so that was 4, 9, and 4. All right, so that's that. And okay, cool. I think I got it now. All right, any movement?
Nope, no movement.
All right. So Frosty is just beside himself in frustration, and he hasn't been able to hit Rorali, and he sees the puny Duradin in front of him, and he attacks Duradin.
Oh, now he learns how to hit it.
All right, both of them hit?
Yeah, both of those do hit.
All right. So you suffer 9 bludgeoning and 3 cold. And 7 bludgeoning and 4 cold.
Jesus.
How much is that total?
That would be 16 plus 7. 23.
Damn.
Are you down?
Yeah.
All right. Alan.
I'll attack with Chromatic Orb this time. Oh, baby.
All right. That hits.
Oh, my Jesus.
Father. That's all fire damage.
Okay. It's fire damage?
Yeah.
All right. So that's
wow. That was only
wow, that was a sucky first roll, wasn't it? All right. So that's what,
29, 40, 58.
50.
Oh shit.
46
plus 12, yeah.
All right. So you hit him with the chromatic orb. What is the area of effect for that?
Or no area of effect, is just direct damage.
Okay. So you take aim at kind of the midsection, and it leaves like a almost like a huge chunk of it has just kind of been circularly cut out. It's all been melted from the damage. And you can see kind of water dripping down the sides and freezing around him.
Okay. Cool. That's my turn.
All right.
It doesn't leave a hole in the middle of them that we can look through.
No, but you can look kind of through the side of them where it kind of hit.
Okay, there's a big chunk now. There's off the a side big missing. Chunk.
Mm-hmm. Duradin. Make a save. Roll a death save. All right, so that one failure. Irad.
Okay, so I'm gonna move like a little bit closer, if that's possible.
No.
Is that where he's at?
Yeah, he's there.
He's size large.
All right, so we're going to do the burning hands again.
Okay.
So, let's see. Okay, so just the 1d6.
It is creature takes. No, this one. So burning hands. I think. We need to make a dexterity. I think your spell DC was a 13.
Yeah.
Okay. So I need to make a dexterity saving throw.
God,
that's a 20. He does.
Oh, bitch.
That was burning hands. That wasn't. Oh, that's a cone, right? Yeah.
Yeah.
I use my inspiration. Fuck that. All right, I take the 19.
Okay. Roll a 3d6.
Wait, does that negate my.
No,
any damage I take?
You take the full damage.
Let's see. No, if I make the saving throw.
If you make the saving throw, then it's halved.
And I have resistance, so is that half again?
If you have you know, I don't think that's intended, but I recall seeing that on the Critical Role episode recently. I'm not positive. I'm going to go with what they went with. So, yes, you can have it again if you do both.
I just have it again? Oh, that's not worth it.
Yeah, so it's one quarter of the damage roll.
Oh, that's not worth it. No, never mind. I keep it. I thought it would negate all damage.
All right, so I take... so he takes half of that, which is 6. Seven. All right. All right, so that you kind of hit him again on the other side this time. So he's kind of... It's almost like he's got two chunks out of either side of him, one bigger than the other, and it's not doing very good. Anything else?
No, that's it.
All right, Archon, your snow person is built.
Doesn't seem that happy about it.
Sounds like he's going to admire his work for a while.
Yeah, he's just going to stand there and see if anything happens.
All right, he's a perfectionist, so he's kind of still fiddling with it. All right, Rorali.
I attack him.
Okay.
That misses. I use my action surge and I attack again.
Okay. That hits.
Item for 13.
All right.
What is my action? And
so you kind of you hit it in the middle, kind of where it's thinnest, and it doesn't look very stable right now.
All right, and I use second wind to get some HP back.
Okay. Makashi.
But you said that he's looking unstable in his like middle snowball thing there.
Yeah.
I will try striking at the middle of him. Which
All right. So you miss.
But I'll use the momentum to do a reverse roundhouse kick.
Okay. That hits. Yeah. All right. So you do a roundhouse kick and you kick at the pillar kind of in the middle of, you know, where he's thinnest. Mm-hmm. And it does seem to knock it out, and as the top part of his body and the lower part of his body, as it starts to, as they start to come together, you see a flash out of one of his eyes, and suddenly he has form now in the middle section. And he has, he has regained 14 hit points.
Oh, Jesus. Oh, that's me.
All right. Frosty is up. Let's see. What do I want to do here? He is going to...
Did Makaji just hand me a healing potion?
Sorry, I got wrapped up on hitting his middle portion.
Next time, friend.
Next time.
Let's see.
I have a healing potion.
Because, I mean, that would be the nice thing to do.
He's going to...
I'll get you
one. He's gonna aim his attack at Makashi because he didn't like that.
I don't like that. The second one hits.
All right.
And I'm gonna use my superiority die to mitigate the damage.
Is that a melee attack?
Good job.
Okay.
So that's just 11.
Okay. Alan.
Back up a little bit and do another force bolt. Sorry, I don't have any healing potions. Unless, is there... I can't... Like, do you have... Have a healing potion on you, Durden, that I would know about?
Probably.
Yeah. Colonel, would you allow me to run up and administer him one of his own healing potions?
After you've moved, or are you moving from where you were?
I don't know. Are you going to let me change my move or no? I was going to move back to attack him, but then I'll
let you go back to where you were.
Okay, so I can get to here, I think, if and try to give him one of his healing potions.
Okay.
All right, I'll do that. And that'll 1, 2, 3, 4, and then I can back up 2, I guess. That'll be my turn.
Okay. All right, so Dryden, you are back alive.
I'll let you roll your hit points, Durden.
I'm trying to remember how many it is for this potion. It is
2d4 plus 2. It's just a regular healing potion, right?
Yeah.
Yep.
I'll take it. Thank you much.
Anytime.
Okay. All right. Just in time for Dryden to make his move.
All right, I am going to heal myself.
Okay.
Delete.
All right. Are you doing anything else?
I'm going to take a one step back.
Okay.
Oh, wait, I probably used my movement standing up, so.
Use half yet. Your movement. Half your
half
movement.
Half of up. It?
Mm-hmm. Watch out for attacks of opportunity.
Can I disengage from him, or is that an action?
That's an action.
That's an action.
Then I will hold my place.
Okay. Irad.
Going to Let me see real quick. Okay, we're gonna hit him with not that. Ignore that.
Okay.
Okay. That.
Force bolt? Magic missile?
Magic missile.
Okay. All right. So that's 12 damage. Oops.
That's 16 damage. You cast it at higher level, Irad?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, which level did you cast it at? Level 2?
So it's 16.
So it's total of 16.
Yeah.
Okay. All right. So you take aim at the midsection again, where he's thinnest, and you knock that whole chunk out, and as the body starts to fall and come together, his other eye blinks, and he regains 17 hit points.
Come on.
I'm going to stab him in the eye.
He should have.
All right, Archon.
All right, go ahead and catch me up. Did I finish my sculpture?
You have finished your sculpture.
All right, so then I, using the cantrip thaumaturgy, I begin to boom my voice and I call for the villagers and the children and all the well-wishers, and we start to sing. And we sing until it animates our snowman.
Nice.
You have that's so stupid.
I'm all about it right now.
Do you have stats for that snowman? Or snow woman?
No, I assumed it'd be the same as the other guy.
You would assume wrong.
Or more powerful if the villagers all believe in a holiday miracle.
I'm all about okay.
this. All right. We'll
see and I keep calling out to them to come in and join and sing with me until we animate it.
The little gnome behind you is just like all about it right now.
All right. So
Colin starts humming along.
There's a few people that have come out from some of the buildings. There aren't a lot of like homes in the square area, so there's not a lot. But the people that have come out feel compelled to join in the song, while they watch the ruckus that's going on. You do find some people up in this area here that have come out. They're staying well away, but they seem to be singing. They're looking around, wondering what is going on, but they don't want to be missing any of the fun or the joy of the song. So they come out, and we'll say that there's your snowman, your snow person. Let me give you control. Actually, you know what? yeah, that's what I'm gonna do. Where are you? You are at the top of my list there. There we go. There you go. All right, you have a snow woman that has been brought to life. I think it'll probably take until next turn until she's actually able to do anything and fully alive. Six
okay,
second
we keep
tune
singing.
Probably is not long enough, but yeah, that'll do. All right. Okay, so all right, so as the folks are singing in the town, a new figure runs around the corner toward the commotion and sees what's going on. And she says, "Oh, good Lord!" And she...
At Erod, though, but what does she think about the snowman?
Oh, by the way, Lucien, take an inspiration. she is going to... she looked right past Erod. And she is going to...
Yeah, how does that even work? I don't even right? understand.
How is that possible?
she is going to... Is everybody all right?
What do you think, small child person?
So the figure that you see before you is a human female. She is approximately... she is approximately 20 years old-ish. Or looks to be in that range. She's wearing a kind of a blue robes, blue cloak, and looks just worried about everybody. So, is anybody hurt?
Yes.
Nah, we'll be okay. So long as you have love in your heart and you truly
Alan,
believe.
I swear to God, I will stab you through with my sword right now.
That's not a very festive attitude.
He spits out a tooth and some blood onto the stone. I'm just fine.
I'm still singeing a little bit.
Is All this right. your snow elemental?
I hate this town.
She looks at you, what?
Are you controlling this thing? And I point my sword at her.
Of course not.
Leave the Wheelos alone. We've got bigger problems.
If there's someone controlling this, we should attend to them. Defeating this foe seems to be proving more difficult than I imagined.
All right, so she's going to... She's going to cast.
Join the cast.
She's going to cast Barkskin on herself.
Oh, thanks, I appreciate it, young woman.
And that's her turn. She is going to insert herself. She's going to be. She's already gone, but she'll go after Rurali on the next turn. All right, Rurali, you're up.
I attack the stupid snow elemental.
Okay.
Or I try to. Once it pops up, I push it. I'll do it again. 25? Assuming hits?
25 hits. It's not coming up yet. There it is.
Hit it right. for 11. Oh, that's what I rolled.
So he just kind of grunts and just screams in frustration and then grins at you. Enjoy. And
I grin at him.
And this is not, you're not seeing this. But he tips his hat in your direction. And...
So cordial.
Alan, I will stab you. I feel no regret.
And four snowmen appear.
Go for Alden.
Behind you and between you.
They come up from the ground.
Actually, they're not going to have their own initiative. They're going to go on the initiative of Frosty. All right, so they won't move until the next turn. What was your question?
Do they rise up from the ground, or do they spin in some magic?
Yeah. So there's kind of a flurry like a magic wind that just kind of works up the snow and seems to form these little snowmen. They are smaller than you, but they are there nonetheless. any movement?
Nope, I stay there.
All right.
Grinning up at Frosty the Buckface.
I want to use my free hand to jump up and try to grab the eyeball that kept flashing before he kept rebuilding himself.
So both eyeballs flashed at different times?
I'll try to grab one of them.
Okay, so for that, I think what I'm going to have you do is roll an attack and then roll a acrobatics. Actually, you know what? Just a dexterity. Just a dexterity.
So an attack with my unarmed strike?
Yeah. Okay, so now roll a dexterity. All right, so you pluck one of his eyes, and you now have a lump of coal in your hand.
And that's all you get for Christmas.
he looks at you and just starts.
And Makashi kind of sighs and breathes out the smoky a breath filling the air, and he drops the coal on the ground, and that'll be my turn.
All right, Frosty is up, and he is not pleased. He is going to sweep his broom at Makashi.
What?
So the weapon ignores resistance to slashing damage. On hit, the broomstick will resonate after the slashing damage is dealt with a localized force wave directed at the target. Creature must make a DC 10 dexterity save or be knocked prone. Creature immune to bludgeoning automatically makes a save.
But it doesn't do any... Oh, nope. There you go. Jesus Christ.
Holy shit, man.
Alright. So dex save. Luckily, I have...
All right, so you're good.
Some dexterity saving.
So as he hits,
do I take half damage of that or full?
No, damage? No. You're not. So you avoid getting knocked prone.
Uh huh.
So you grab onto the broomstick as it hits you, and you kind of right yourself as you're falling. So you're not knocked prone.
Are you down?
No, he's up. Oh, hit point.
Yeah, but what about the damage?
Damage is 16, yep.
Yeah, so it's not half with the save?
No. The save is just to prevent you from getting knocked prone.
All right, well,
so if you are down, then you're down.
That knocks me off my ass regardless.
Oh, okay. All right. Okay. Alan. Oh, I'm sorry. Before that, so Snowman 1 He's going to target he's going to target Rurali.
Oh, the second one hits.
Second one hits.
We're 1,000.
This guy here is going to chuck some snowballs at Alan.
Miss. This is a ranged attack?
Yeah. Just out of range because he's small.
Is it 11 and 12?
No, I'm sorry. No, he's not. He's not. The smallness messed me up. So he's in melee range. So he instead is going to use cold hands.
That will miss.
All right. This guy here is going to do the same because he's got no choice.
That will miss.
And this guy here is going to attack Rurali. Nope. Ignore that. Cold hands and misses. All right. So they all miss. They're small. They have bad aim. Alan, you're up.
I am going to move 10, 20, 30, 4, 5 to about here. I think there'll be some attacks of opportunity, or no?
Yeah, two of them.
Go ahead. Miss.
Man.
Double miss.
Their
oh, baby.
Rolls are really good. All right.
So right here, where I was standing, I'm going to cast Shatter.
Okay.
So that they all have to make a dex save. Is it con or dex? Let me check. They have to make a saving throw, and if they are not made of organic material, they have disadvantage.
Okay.
It is
click the spell? It
should be sure. One sec. That didn't put it up, did it?
Yep. DC 14.
Okay. Yeah.
All right. All three of them or four of them?
So that'll hit all four. It's a 10-foot distance. Did I say what kind of saving throw it was? It's a con save.
All three of them make the saving throw.
All four?
Well, the fourth one is out. Oh, yep. My bad. The small guys. It's hard to figure out where they are. The fourth one does not make the saving throw. And he takes, what, 14 damage?
Yeah, and the other ones take half, so 7.
The other ones take 7?
Yep.
All right, so they are all wiped out.
All right, that's my turn.
All right, good job. Duradin.
As Makashi falls from the blow by the broom, Durden's going to reach out and just grab him by the front of his shirt, pull him back up to his feet, and swat him in the side of the head and tell him to get back into the fight.
I assume that's your medicine check.
No, that's me casting Cure Wounds on you.
I was going to say, make sure you don't hit him too hard.
Nice.
Okay.
And that will end my turn.
All right.
Irod.
All right, so going to hit him again.
All right. What are you hitting him with?
I'm actually going to do something else. I'm going to use spider climb.
Okay.
And I'm going to go up on the building above him.
Okay.
Right there. And that's my turn.
Okay. All right. All right. So, so the new adventurer is going to didn't set up our macros. She is going to she is going to run over. Actually, what is the range on this? All right, so she's going to cast Healing Word at level 2 on Nakashi, who she saw go down. And that gives you 10 hit points again.
All right. And
she is, that's her turn. Archon.
I'm less inclined to stab her in the back now.
Are these squares 5 feet, or is the ruler not working?
They're ruler's not working.
Okay.
They're supposed to be 5 feet. I might have gone the wrong way when I did the conversion.
Dash. I assume the snowman moves at that same speed.
Yeah, sure.
And we still have the song going.
Yep. You're being serenaded.
Way. We're getting louder. And I'm using thaumaturgy so the whole town can hear us.
All right.
And we're rushing forward to help.
All right. So you see a lot of people in the streets, kind of in this direction. Coming out of their houses to see what's going on. All right, so that's your turn.
Yeah, and while I'm running there, I'm yelling to the townsfolk as we're singing, and I'm like, you know, there are people having trouble making the miracles happen. There are people who don't have enough to eat. There are people who are cold. You can go out and you can just say hello to these people. You can take an old blanket out of the closet and give it to them and just say, here. And you can make them a sandwich and just say, oh, by the way, here, as we run.
You can give them leftovers from the Chinese restaurant. Oh,
man. All right. Raleigh.
I attacked this son of a bitch in front of me. And I missed.
Well, now, what did I do?
All right. Anything else?
That's the end of my turn.
All right, Makashi.
I'm going to jump up and try to snatch the other eye.
Okay.
Boom.
All right. Dexterity.
Boom. Oh.
So you jump up, and just as your hand gets really close to that eye, one of his branch arms just swats your hand away. And the branch feels a lot stronger than you would have thought a branch would feel.
I bet. Can I use my bonus action for another strike to for another go at the eye?
Sure.
Yeah, see, so he swats one hand away. I'm like, nah, bump that fool. Whoops. it's a 17.
Yeah, that does.
And then dexterity. Yo.
Okay, so you snatch the other eye.
Then I drop. No, I drop the other one on the ground. Oh. And
so you have. I both look of his back eyes. For
a response. Is he blind now?
You can't tell, but he seems really peeved off.
Hmm. I don't know. And I just chuck the other. Actually, no, I'll hold on to that one.
Okay.
Chuck it on the next turn. And that's my. Nope.
All right. So he's still looking in your direction and does a
bring it
another attack.
First one hits. Kagoosh. 12.
All right. Alan.
I'll move up here to be with the crowd. I'll be like leading the crowd of people who are approaching, singing their song. I'll be like the Pied Piper. I'm going to force bolt dude.
Okay.
Does not have love in his heart. I'm too distracted by the singing to aim properly. All right.
The choreography is a little off. It's in there. We'll work on it, Adeline. We'll work on it.
I am going to lay the hammer down.
Did you actually put it down?
Yeah, apparently. I'm going to blow another domain power to swing again.
Okay, that hits. 4-3. All right, so you take another chunk out of that midsection. It's still standing. There's still part of it left.
That's it for me.
All right, Irod. Spider form or spider walk.
All right. So from this angle, I want to use burning hands again.
Okay.
So it's going to go that way.
Okay.
Fuck you, Temple.
Yeah. It's not going to damage anything. All right, so he has to roll a dex saving throw. And he misses. And he melts. So he melts. You melt the midsection. And he does appear to lose lifelessness or life. He goes, you know what I mean? And then and then he kind of shimmers, like a shimmery cloud kind of engulfs him, and he changes what he looks like. And
he looks more jolly.
He does.
I attack him with my hammer.
Hey. Hold on, I'm not finished yet. There. All right, so he kind of sits there. His midsection is reformed, but he looks a lot more docile, a lot softer around the edges. And now instead of stick arms, he actually has like snow arms, and he says, "Happy birthday!"
I'm hitting him with my hammer.
What? Okay. No, it is my birthday, guys.
We already have a snowman.
All right, go ahead.
Wait, whose birthday is it?
Alan is claiming it's his birthday.
So who gets to give him the spanking?
Are you still in turn order, I'm assuming?
Are you hitting him?
Yeah, he's even worse now.
I would love to hit him.
All right. Are you gonna roll an attack?
Oh, I thought we were rolling out of order then.
Well, we're out of battle.
Right. Okay. Yours?
So as he sees, he kind of focuses his attention on Archon as Archon's running up to him, and he then sees the Snow Woman coming at him, and he just has a big smile on his face, and then Duradin's Warhammer just comes crashing through his face, knocking the hat away, and his face is crushed and just completely missing now. And the form goes lifeless, and his arms return back to sticks.
No!
Stupid.
Alan runs up, and he picks up the hat and kind of like dusts it off and places it back on his head.
But the power of our singing rematerializes him.
and my tears of sadness kind of probably do something magical.
So... You put the hat back on, but his head is gone, so it's now
rest on his neck.
and he's you kind of hear him go.
Yay! So I'm gonna try to rebuild his head with the snow that has fallen.
Okay, so as you're doing that, the commotion subsides, and out of the front door.
Comes all in.
Appears this gentleman. And you also the emissary Kruger appears as well. And he kind of walks up toward Frosty and stands beside the other gentleman. And he looks and then kind of investigates Frosty as Alan, you're kind of putting the finishing touches on rebuilding his head. And he says, and Kruger says, well, he'll be no trouble anymore. And then he turns to the party and he nods towards Nicholas. And Nicholas appears to recognize Kruger. Emissary, he says with a nod and greeting. He has a concerned look on his face. Is this what you were talking about? Kruger nods to him, and he says, it's only going to get worse if this isn't taken care of quickly. You, my friend Nicholas, are in grave danger. I brought these heroes to help deal with this threat. Midwinter brings a time of year when the barrier between the Feywild and the Material Plane is thin. In this town, it has become particularly thin each year as the Yuletide Festival has grown. The festive atmosphere, the song, and the tributes feed this. It's a good thing. But with Loviatar trying to quell the festival, the barrier will become much stronger and prevent easy travel between planes, interfering with Oberon's fertile hunting grounds. My Lady of Eternal Celebration tells me she has secured the help of Oberon of the Fae, who gives eight of his charges, centaurs of a sort, to serve and protect Nicholas and Helmfirth from danger. And across the square... kind of a veil appears to shimmer around here. And oh, you stupid thing. It's not cooperating. And eight reindeer walk through it. Kruger introduces them as Dasher, Dancer, Prancer, Vixen, Comet, Cupid, Donner, and Blitzen. You hear a greeting in your head in common, seemingly from each of them. Kruger explains that they are centaurs who have agreed to have their appearance permanently altered to look like reindeer so they can live among the humans. Blitzen says in everybody's head, Lord Oberon has informed us that he has heard of a large creature in a cave to the north, and surmises that this may be the ultimate threat to the village and to Sir Nicholas. Kluger nods. That must be it. If anyone knows these mountains, it is Oberon. We can't waste any time. And Blitzen paws the ground with a hoof and nods his head, his broad antlers looking majestic. Donner and I will join you in this mission. The rest will stay behind to protect Nicholas. What would the party like to do?
I would like to take a short rest. So
that sounds like a good plan. Let's do that. That's a good time for that. All right, we'll take a short break.
Can I hit the snowman again?
All right, guys, we're going to go on break real quick. I'll bring the stream back in. So stay tuned.